Well, good morning, Grace.
Good morning, Grace.
I'm going to welcome you here Sunday morning. We thought we'd do worship back in the building, just give you a sense that it still exists. Here we are in the worship center at Grace, and though it's very empty without all of you, but we are here to worship. So let's start with worshiping God through the song, The Solid Rock of Jesus Christ.
Hi, Pastor Mark. I just want to thank you and all the people behind the scenes that have been keeping us informed, encouraged, and connected during these crazy times. It's just been such a blessing to be able to view the service online, to wake up and know that there are other church members having devotions together. And it's just been really a blessing. So thank you so much for all your hard work.
Hello, Grace family.
Hi, I'm Barbara Richardson. I just wanted to let everybody know I want to thank Pastor Mark and Martha and Alyssa Tucker and Sierra Para for everything they're doing for our church and everybody else that's keeping us in touch. I miss all of you so much. I'll be glad to see you when we can get back together. Have a good day.
Cleaning Johnny on the spot for some spinning cash, so I can buy my it's me here, Pastor Mark Johnson. Good morning. How are you? I was just out for my daily 72-mile bike ride, and I'm a little out of breath today because I decided to bring my bride, Martha, along with me here in my backpack. You know, I just thought, why not? Why not let her experience the views that I get to see every day without having to do the heavy-duty work of mountain biking? So I just shoved her in there. She has her thermos of tea, so she's good to go. But in a minute, she's going to hop out, and we're going to just take in the beauty of what's behind me. It's my favorite vista point. It's the Jackson Shopping Center back there. And I just really like to come up here and, you know, decompress and get closer to God and everything. And so I'm real excited she's here to experience that with me today. And fun fact, our favorite restaurant's back there in the distance, KFC. It's where we like to go for our date nights. So, I'm glad I could share this with you guys. But while I'm up here, why don't I bring you the announcements? Give Sierra and Alyssa a break. They work so hard. So, you know, announcement number one is the May newsletter is ready. It is good to go. You can find that at our church website. It's just a great way to stay connected. So make sure you check that out after church, of course. Not right now. So make sure you go onto the church website for that. And announcement number two is that if you haven't already, please download the Instant Church Directory app onto your phone. Another great way to stay connected with everybody right now. And if you haven't already, make sure you upload your family's information. Directions for that will be given after the service today. But make sure you download that right now or after the service, either one. Make sure it gets downloaded though. Well, those are all the announcements I have for you today. I'm glad I got to share this beauty of the view behind me, and that, you know, in the words of my mentor, Alyssa Tucker, happy Sunday.
Good morning, church. It's giving time. So many things in our lives right now are changing so fast and just going away, stopping. But praise God, if you look around, you will see that giving has not stopped. Even though needs are way up, incomes are taking a hit, people are still reaching out to each other, looking out for their neighbors, providing what they can. A generous Christian friend made us masks, which we really needed, just because we needed them. Christians don't shut down their giving in tough times. We just keep following Jesus. While we're apart physically right now, we can still join together to support the ongoing work of this church. You can make your offering by mailing it to the church office, by giving through the app, or through the church website. Let's pray together. Lord, gather our offering from your scattered people today and use it to work your will. Please bless those who are dealing with illness and loss of income. Give us this day our daily bread. Increase our faith and quiet our hearts. We turn to you and we love you and we trust you. Amen. Promise still stands.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Homie, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. You open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, you are worthy. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. My eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my beside you. You open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Good morning, Grace Fellowship. Welcome this morning to another beautiful Sunday that we get to worship God, count our blessing, dive into the Word of God, and hear from God through His Holy Spirit today. Now, before we get to the text, I just want a couple of things I want to remind us of. One is to be praying for Debbie King. This past week, her husband Rich went to be with the Lord. Many of you probably already know this. And so we just want to be lifting up Debbie and giving her good support and encouragement during this difficult time as she grieves. And we also acknowledge the rejoicing that Rich is in the presence of God. He is realizing the reality of everything that he looked forward to through faith in Jesus Christ. That's something we all get promised. And he is experiencing the reality. 1 month to the day later than my dad entered into glory, and we are, though we grieve his loss, he is there experiencing the very same thing in the presence of God and all of those who have preceded us in death. And so remember Debbie and those who are grieving because of loss here on this earth, even as we rejoice in the hope that is ours in Jesus Christ. The second thing is that you might be surprised to see me this morning when last week I said that Pastor Matthew was going to be giving today's message as we moved forward in our study of Colossians. Well, that has changed in that I reached out to Matthew this week and I said, Matthew, would you mind holding off one more week on moving forward in the text? Because I felt like I wanted to take a little bit more time with the passage that we've already covered. And I hope by the end of today, you understand why. So in preparation for that, let's stop and ask for God to fill us with his Holy Spirit and illumine our minds to hear from him today. Will you join me in prayer? Father, we're just so grateful for your love for us, that you have given us the truth of your word. You have put faith in our hearts to keep our eyes focused on Christ during a time of uncertainty. And today I pray that that is essentially true in its most vital ways. Speak to us today through your word, through the power of your Holy Spirit today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I want to, as we move forward in our time together today, I just want to remind us of our text. And just, I'm going to focus on one central theme here, and that is Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. So if you have your Bible, open up to Colossians chapter 2, and we're just going to look at that one verse, and we're going to build our message today on that. And here's what it says. Paul is writing, he says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world," or the elemental spirits of the world, "rather than on or in accord with Christ." So that was the central message of last Sunday, and we talked about competing philosophies. Let me illustrate this point before we get much further. So right here on my table, I have three cups and a little red ball. So if there's any kids in the room, this might be of interest to you, but I think all of us can get this. Here's what Paul is saying, that Jesus, whom we're gonna represent as this little red ball, is where we should be focusing and prioritizing our faith, our attention, all of our values. He is the one who defines for us our worldview, which we call a biblical worldview. And Paul is saying, once he has set us free from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, well, then that kind of dictates everything we do. We're rooted and established in him, and we should also walk according to what we know about Jesus, in whom the fullness of deity dwells. So, there is Jesus, and our focus is upon him, being built up, rooted in him, established in the faith. And these cups represent competing philosophies. Paul points out human tradition and the elemental spirits of the world, but any philosophy really that competes with our focus on Jesus to dictate all that we say and do should be put in a subordinate position. He makes the argument that because Jesus is supreme, he is ruler above all, he has created all things, that everything according to the created realm, by its very nature, is inferior to the Creator. It's subordinate. It should become under the authority of the Creator. And so we shouldn't put these competing philosophies on the same level as Jesus and somehow be held captive by this. And you're familiar with this game. It's called a shell game. So we take the red ball, we put it under a cup, and through misdirection, we turn the cups around. Now, your job this morning is to keep your eye on whatever cup you think the red ball is under. I'm doing my best at kind of misdirecting your attention so that at some point you have no idea where the ball went. That's the goal of the game, is to try to beat the misdirection. So, is it cup number one, cup number two, cup number three? Where did the red ball go? What do you think? Well, nope, if you thought that cup, you're wrong. What about this cup? Oh, you're wrong again. Where is it? It was right back in the middle. This is what competing philosophies do. Through misdirection, it allows you to start focusing on something else other than Jesus, and in the end, you don't realize that you've lost track or lost sight of the ultimate superiority and sufficiency of Jesus in how we conduct our lives. What Paul is saying is that you have been given Jesus and you've been established in the faith, the clear teaching about Jesus, who Jesus is, what he taught about himself, and how the apostles teach about him. So in reality, when we are being informed by the Bible, it's as if the ball never got covered, in fact, that it's on top. So let me try this again. Where is the red ball? I'm going to try to misdirect you. I'm going to put it somewhere else. You get the point. We never lose sight of the red ball when it is on top and it's forefront and in the center of our attention. And this is the point that Paul is making. Don't let other philosophies or other things that are part of this created realm misdirect us from our attention to the plan and purpose of God that is centered in Jesus Christ. Why is this message so important? Because I believe that there are so many competing values, competing worldviews that would get even the most sincere believers off track. Even I am subject to this. I'm a pastor. My whole life is dedicated to the Word of God and to leading people, hopefully by example, all these things. And I have to check my heart all the time to make sure that Jesus remains in the center of my value system and where I place my attention and my faith. There's lots of things that compete for my attention. Now, during this time with COVID-19, people have been asking me, what is the role of the church and what is God doing? Well, initially, when we were no longer able to hold services in this building, our primary concern was, how are people feeling connected, that we don't feel isolated? How do we support one another? And so we as leadership got together and put a bunch of plans in place to make sure that we all felt supported and encouraged. We put our services online so you could see this at home, even though we can't meet together. I started doing a daily devotion, at least Monday through Thursday at 7 a.m. on Facebook, so we could feel connected. We encouraged small groups to meet via Zoom so we could feel connected and encouraged. I think we've accomplished that goal on a number of levels. But as the weeks have worn on, and it looks like, as we watch the news, that the weeks ahead, we don't know in the foreseeable future when we'll be able to bring our congregation back together to enjoy some of the things that we've always enjoyed before COVID-19. I think that God has put in my heart a shift, not just to think about how do we stay encouraged, how do we stay supported, but what is the central voice of the church during a time like this? And I think that there are two answers to that question when we look to the Bible for these answers. So what is God doing in the world? It's the church's responsibility to let people know. First of all, to understand it, and second of all, to let people know what God is doing. Several people have asked me the question, do you think this plays into some end time prophecy that precedes the return of Jesus? Are we in the last days? Is Jesus coming soon? And I think this is a really great question. And although I cannot point to a particular prophecy that COVID-19 fits into that immediately precedes the return of Christ, here's what I do know, that God often uses events like this throughout human history to wake up God's people in the faith. And the Bible certainly not only endorses, but promotes the idea that we should be watchful for Christ's return. We should be looking for his return, watching for it on the horizon, examining the signs. And so events like this help us to put ourselves on a higher alert to look for and be ready for the return of Jesus. So the two areas that I want to cover today that I think are helpful to us are, in order to be ready for Christ's return, is one, that the Bible endorses personal repentance, and number two, emphasize the importance of proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why personal repentance? Well, think about when Jesus came the first time. God sent ahead of him a messenger, John the Baptist, who was a prophet who had the duty of preparing that generation for the coming of Messiah. And so his message was that to proclaim everywhere that the kingdom of God was at hand. It's about to take place. Messiah is coming. And what should everyone's response be? Repentance. Examine our hearts. If we're allowing ourselves to be misdirected in all kinds of ways and not prioritizing God, John the Baptist's role was to say, no, focus in on what God is doing right now. Open up your hearts. Get rid of anything that would distract you, because in any day now, Jesus will be here. And we know the rest of the story, that Jesus arrived, John the Baptist baptized Jesus and said, this is the one whom I'm telling you about. This is the one that's going to take away the sins of the world. I'm not worthy of untying his sandals. Here is the Messiah. And Jesus began his ministry. So the importance of having a heart that is alert, a heart that is repentant, a heart that is primed to see and be ready for Christ's return is the message of John the Baptist. So how did the people take to John's message? There were two groups generally, ones that repented and were ready, and when they saw Jesus, they said, wow, look at this. No one has taught like this person with the authority that Jesus does. Look at all the miracles he does. He must be Messiah, and they placed their faith in him. Then there are those who didn't take time to repent, didn't take time to manage their own heart because they were pretty content in their own righteousness. What do I need to repent of? I'm doing great. These were the religious leaders of that first century. And it was those people who did not prepare their hearts that saw the very same things, the authority of Jesus and the miracles, and they discounted them because they got so focused on their own pride, on their own envy of Jesus' popularity, they began to minimize the role of Jesus and say, he can't be Messiah. Why? Because he's violating the Sabbath. That's one of the big things they would point out. Jesus would perform a miracle on the Sabbath day. And they were so hung up that he did something like that on the Sabbath that they missed the very miracle that pointed to the fact that Jesus was the Son of God, Messiah. Miracles that were unexplainable other than God's supernatural anointing of Jesus. Miracles like an invalid that it was paralyzed for 30 years. Everybody knew of this person. He was around for 30 years. And also to see this person up and walking with strong legs, everybody's asking, how did this happen? This points to the reality of the sovereignty of Jesus, that he is the Son of God. Yet that's not what the Pharisees focused on. They said, no, he did that on the Sabbath. A man who was born blind, everybody who around and saw that miracle that Jesus gave him sight, they said, no one has ever heard of such a thing that someone being born blind now can see. He was an adult. Everybody was used to seeing him at that gate begging because he couldn't work because he couldn't see. And now he's walking around, he's identifying people, he's seeing, and they're saying, how on earth can this happen? And the man himself would say, Jesus opened my eyes. These are signs that point to Jesus as Messiah. There are people who were ready and received that message and placed their faith in Jesus, and there are those who were not. Jesus helps us by saying, when I come again, there's going to be a generation and there's going to be the same two kinds of people. There are going to be people who were ready and the people who were not. And he differentiates using stories, parables, to tell about those times. And we don't have time to cover them today, but you look at Matthew chapter 25 and you see a series of them. For example, the 10 virgins, five were ready, five were not. You had the parable of the sheep and the goats. There were one group of people who were out there doing the will of God, others were not, and some were rewarded and the others were condemned. You have the parable of the talents, where you have a master who gives three servants in his household money to manage his household. Why? Because he's going to go away, going to go on a long trip. Hey guys, here's some money. I need you to manage my household while I'm gone. I'll be back after a long time, and we'll you know, keep an account of everything. You know, once I return, we'll figure things out. So he goes on his trip. What do those three servants do? Well, two of them take the money that the master gave them, put it to work. They were actively doing in the spirit of the master everything that the master would want in those households, and they were making a profit, and they produced things of value. The third servant took what God, or took what the master gave them, and he didn't do anything with it. He just buried it in the ground. They're all still a part of the household of the master. Two did the will of God, one did not. When the master returned, he rewarded the two and said, "Well done, good and faithful servant." To the one who didn't do anything, who was not prepared for his return, he said, "You wicked and lazy servant." So Jesus is telling us, when I come again, it's going to be a generation where there will be those who are ready for my return and those who are not. How does COVID-19 fit into this? How does the shell game fit into this? Those competing philosophies that misdirect us from Jesus. I'm going to suggest to you two core philosophies that we, particularly in the United States, have adopted that are competing values with Jesus. And they're easy to see. I hope you agree with me that these two values that I'm going to present, there's probably a lot, but I'm going to present two biggies. One is comfort, and the other is security. Comfort and security. Comfort, if I were to put it in a different word, is really having life on our terms. I can do what I want, when I want, how I want. In our culture, we have been afforded that. I work hard, I'm going to get a paycheck. I'm the only one who decides how I'm going to spend that paycheck. I can put a roof over my head. I can have a really nice house. I can go out and do recreational things. I can put whatever clothes I want on. And I do these things however I want. I do it my way on my terms. And this is a blessing. I'm not saying this is a bad thing. This is wonderful. We've all enjoyed this. And it leads to a sense of security. So security, comfort is having life on my terms, how I want it, when I want it, you know, who I want it with, whatever. And security just takes that same idea and presses it out to the future. That I'm going to do things that secure, as long as I look at my future and I see that I can continue to be comfortable having life on my terms, I'm okay. I'm going to have money in the bank. If some problem happens down the road, money. I have money to take care of that. I have a health care system that's going to help me when I get sick. I have this security laid up for me in the future that things are just going to keep, in my world, are just going to keep going every day the way that I want them to. And this is wonderful. Again, I'm not saying this is bad. This is great, wonderful things that are capitalistic society, the freedoms that we enjoy under the banner of our Constitution, all good, wonderful things. We all enjoyed them. We've enjoyed them to the extent that we could be connoisseurs of coffee, right? In what culture in the cultures in the world, other than very affluent cultures, does anybody care about the differentiation between different kinds of coffees? Where we say, oh, I don't drink coffee from that place. I don't like, you know, their beans don't taste the way, and I prefer this kind of coffee. And we become connoisseurs in our culture. We get to enjoy the beauty, the aroma, the wonder of even just the nuances of coffee. That's a pretty comfortable existence, and we can enjoy that. Blessings. Here's where these philosophies become competing philosophies with Jesus, is when you disrupt that comfort and that security. How close to home are they? How, what is our response when that happens? How do we get angry? Do we look for someone to blame? That is, of course, what is happening. We get irritated. I'm frustrated that we can't meet together as a church. I'm frustrated that I can't go out and camp, that we had to cancel our trip to Israel. And so many of you have canceled your plans and graduations and weddings, and we can't even hold funerals right now. These are very serious and painful things. So when God allows circumstances to threaten our comfort and security to be able to do things on our terms, when we want, what we want, it's painful. So where do we put our hope when things like this happen? Well, what is our greatest desire? Maybe an answer to that question is, what is our greatest desire right now? Is it consumed with, I just want things to return back to normal? I just want the comfort and security back. If that is our greatest priority in our thinking, then this comfort and security have just become competing philosophies with the supremacy of Jesus Christ in our life. God does not promise us comfort and security. Even, and Paul would say, who is one who went without comfort and security all of his ministry for Jesus, would say, these present difficulties, our present sufferings, are nothing compared to the glory we're going to receive when we see Jesus face to face. So the first point, when God is doing something in the world like this, who is disrupting our comfort and security, he is actually doing us a favor by awakening in our hearts that these things have become in a position of God in our lives. And as important as they are, and I would love for those things to return. Don't get me wrong. I want them just as much as anybody else. But this opportunity has afforded me a clear light in the areas of my heart that have allowed me to be misdirected as to what is the most important thing in the world. Let me read for you a scripture, Matthew chapter 7, and just hear these words of Jesus about where do we place our ultimate value, or the things that we put our trust in. How do we build our house, our own world? What is it built upon? What kind of foundation? Listen to this with regard to Jesus' words. Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house. COVID-19 came and blew against our house, yet it did not fail. It did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. COVID-19 came and that house fell with a great crash. All I'm saying is this. I'm not on my high horse telling you that, you know, what to do. I'm telling you as a voice of the church, as a voice of a pastor, a voice who is trying to understand the Word of God, that I myself am examining my life, and I'm coming to realize that a lot of my house has been built upon sand. And to that extent, the discomfort I'm experiencing right now, the uncertainty of my future, is allowing a lot of how I structured my comfort and safety and my focus begins to erode away. And I'm realizing how I've allowed my life to shift from that rock of doing Jesus Christ. What is building our house upon the rock? Jesus says, if you hear my words and you put them into practice. This is where the church is going to absolutely shine, is when we allow our comfort and security to be secondary and bring back into a primary focus doing the will of God in our generation. That is going to make us a generation of people who are ready for Christ's return when he comes. This is our dress rehearsal. This is our test. How are we doing? How do we need to open our hearts back to Jesus? How do we need to prioritize Jesus? People, if you are more upset about you're not being able to get your $5 latte versus someone who is dying apart from Christ. We have built our house on the sand. If we are focusing our attention on our future security of our retirement or whether or not my business is going to prosper or not prosper, as important and vital as that is, if it's equal to or greater, our focus is greater than that on Jesus, we have built our house on the sand. There's just no other way to put it. God is doing us a favor, and I hope that He restores our economy. I hope that we get to return to meeting together. I hope that we do have comfort and security in the beautiful and wonderful things that we have in the future. But if we do not, I know that we'll be okay if our focus, our attention, our priorities are on Jesus Christ. Because one day we will see Him face to face, and these things will no longer matter. All that will matter is the reality of our faith, standing in His presence and hearing the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Are we doing the will of God right now? And what does that look like? How are we praying for one another? How are we telling people about Jesus? How are we serving one another? How are we a voice of stability and peace and encouragement that is unmoved by fear of a loss of potential security? People have asked me about, what if the church can never meet again? I mean, I don't think that's going to happen, but okay, let's play that out. What if we can't meet in this building? Guess what? The church has never been about the building. Even if all throughout history, as the governments have oppressed churches, I hope that's not what's going to happen to us, but as the governments have said, it's illegal to gather to worship God, the church just goes underground. It doesn't stop existing. And I'm telling you that in times like this, this is where the church thrives, because we lose the reality that, you know, this building, this is an edifice of worship. And I get so sick of a time, and I'm getting on my soapbox, bear with me, starting to preach here, where people choose churches not because of right doctrine, not because of being a part of a family of God who are about doing the kingdom of God's work. They choose churches because, oh, I like that pastor. Oh, that pastor's not funny enough. You know, doesn't keep me entertained or keep me interested. Oh, I like the music there. Oh, they got a good children's program. And that's really the extent of how we choose churches. Where is our priorities? Not having this building and all of the privileges of nuances of worship and nuances of pastoral teaching, and, ooh, I prefer this, I prefer that. Remove all that. The church can still thrive because our focus is on Jesus, not on the church building, not on our ability to gather. We can just go underground and continue to gather. The church can thrive in times like this, and we have to wake up and see that priority. Let us repent of anything that contends, any philosophy that contends with our absolute focus on Jesus Christ. The second thing is the importance of proclaiming the good news. Now, if we have the answer, if the Word of God has made it so clear that Jesus is not going to be covered up, we got to let the whole world know about this, because everybody else is still held captive by the dominion of darkness. They don't know that God is in control. They don't know that God has a plan, that there's greater things at stake other than our comfort and security. We have got to tell people about Jesus. How are we doing that well? How are we praying for our neighbors, our coworkers, our family members who have not placed their faith in Jesus? Because the reality is that Jesus is going to come again, and with Him will come judgment. Let me read for you a couple of passages that are so key for us to understand. The first one is in Luke chapter 17, in verses 26 and 27. These are Jesus' words. He says this about His return: "Just as it is, or as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the Son of Man when He returns. They were eating and drinking, marrying and being given in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark. And the flood came and destroyed them all." When the Son of Man comes, it'll be like the days of Noah. Life will be going on. We'll have comfort and security. People will be married, given in marriages. They're looking for the future. They're not looking at what's happening today. They're looking around, and that's, even though Noah, a prophet of their time, was saying, hey, a flood is coming. It is in that time the flood came and destroyed them all. Let me bring to you another passage. This is from the Apostle Paul, and we just studied this some months ago in 1 Thessalonians in chapter 5, verses 1 through 3. Paul says, now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates with regard to Christ's return, we do not need to write you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, while people are saying, peace, safety, comfort, security. Destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. The reality is, when Jesus comes, there will be people who are ready and there will be people who are not. And at that point, judgment will come, and eternity is what as follows. Jesus will set up his kingdom on earth, and those of us who are ready will enter into that kingdom and enjoy living in his presence in a new creation and receiving all the wonders of his promises. But we must be ready. We must be ready by checking our heart and repenting personally of anything that would compete with our focus on Jesus Christ and the prioritization of Jesus Christ. And we must help other people be ready by the proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. If you are watching this video and you are not part of our church, or you've maybe stumbled upon it in some way, I just want you to know God loves you. He has not destined you for wrath, for destruction, for condemnation. He is giving you this message today so that your heart will be ready when he returns. And you could be ready by placing your faith in Jesus. God loves you. He loves you so much that he sent his Son to earth to live a life just like we live. As a man, yet he was the Son of God, so he lived it perfectly. So when he went to the cross and was crucified, the Bible tells us that that death paid the penalty for the sin of all of humanity. That's our sin that the Bible tells us separates us from God and condemns us, because God is holy and righteous. But because God loves us, he sent his Son to die, that penalty paying for our sins. When we place our faith and trust in Jesus, the Bible tells us we are forgiven of all of our sin, and we receive eternal life. And we get to now be a part of God's plan, and that things like COVID-19 and the struggle of our human government to help us return to peace and safety isn't our hope. Jesus is. Place our faith in Jesus, and you have guaranteed eternal life in all the glories that are awaiting those who have faith in him. And I appeal to you, place your faith in Jesus. Do the will of God. Live according to his promises. And rejoice when we get to enjoy comfort and security. Rejoice. These are blessings. But when these things can be threatened or even go away, Jesus remains. If he is a priority of our lives, then we should not fear anything. We have eternal life and the reward of servants whom, when the master returns, will say, well done, good and faithful servant, enter in to my glory. Let me pray for you all today. Father, I thank you for these words that open up our minds to understand the reality of who you are, that you have a plan, that you are working things out in the world. Open up our hearts and our minds to be attentive, to be awake, to be mindful of these things so that we are ready for your return. Help us to call out the things of our heart that have threaten to compete with you and your priority in our. I confess these things of my own life, areas of comfort and security that have crept in, and this disruption, God, has allowed me to see how much I have built my house on that foundation of sand. God, I repent of that. Help me to focus my attention back on you. And for those who have placed their faith in you today, God, thank you. We praise you. We pray that by your promises of your word, you will come and dwell in each of us who have placed our faith in you. By the person of your Holy Spirit,
strengthen them, open their minds to understand your plan. Give them peace when our security is being threatened. Help them to have a peace of knowing that you are in control and that you reward those who are doing your will when you return. God, we pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, parts of this might have been painful today to hear, but I hope it's also an encouragement. I pray that we all would continue to move forward in our faith today, praying for you. Be blessed today. Keep our eyes focused on Jesus.
I want to remind you guys about our new church directory that we have, Instant Church Directory. If you haven't downloaded this on your phone or your device, I encourage you to go and do that right now. Four easy steps to get it on your phone or your device. So, number one, download the app. It's called Instant Church Directory, and the actual icon will be a white church with a bright green background. And then after you've downloaded it, you can log on. You need to make a login with it with your email address that you gave to Karen for the directory, and then you make a password. After that, they will send you an email to your email address. You follow those directions and then you can log in. From there, you have access to your account and you can upload your picture if you haven't done that already or change any of your information. It is so great that we have access to this app now more than ever because it is so important that we stay connected to one another as a church family and with our community. I encourage you guys to reach out to others in our church through text or phone call, send them a letter. Just keep one another encouraged and remember that we are all in this together.